Sophisticated Serkins here. Hope you guys are having a great Sunday and have had a great week this week. We got some really exciting stuff. We got a surprise mail coming Tuesday we're going to do an unboxing of. So really excited to show you guys what's coming in. It's going to be a mail that's going to make some crazy stuff coming up for us and some stuff you guys are going to really, really dig. So first off today, we're going to answer some viewer questions. So we actually had one of our viewers that asked a great question on our last YouTube video, which is how do you know when it's time to retire a snake and how do you go about that as far as when it comes to breeding? So for me, when females and males are a little bit different. So typically for males, they just kind of naturally retire after a couple of years because I'm usually done using them and just are keeping them as a pet at that point once their son or their grandson comes of age and I'm now breeding them. But with males, I would stop once you start to see slugs, and of course stop once you start to see the animal's health decline in any way. So if you have a male that's just, he's, you know, maybe 10 years old or something, and you're just starting to see him lose more and more weight each breeding season and have a harder time putting that weight back on, that's when I'd retire him. But like I said, usually for most breeders, males will kind of retire themselves and become pets after you have their son or their grandson be raised up. Now when it comes to females, a lot of people do this differently. So for me, I always keep track, and I recommend everyone does, of how many eggs each season a female has. So once a female starts to decline, that's when I really start to pay attention in eggs. So she'll go up to a maximum number of eggs she's going to ever have, and then she's going to start to decline sometimes. And once she starts to decline, that's when I start really keeping track and starting to see, is this putting a lot of stress on her? How much weight is she losing after she lays? And it's kind of a judgment call. Now, if you start to see that she's having mostly slugs year after year, that's kind of your signal that she's done. Awesome, you have a big snake as a pet, which is why we do this, is to hang out with them. But like I said, you know, the main thing is you got to be gauging that. You got to look at her health, look at her weight, look at how she's been doing every single year and make a judgment based off that and what you think is best for your female and her health. So now, guys, we're going to jump in to showing you guys some Retic morphs. We've been having a lot of questions about some basics, like what's the difference between tiger and sunfire. So we're going to show you guys right now a normal, a sunfire, a tiger, and a sun tiger to give you guys a good grasp of what all these different genes do and what they look like combined. Okay, guys, so here are some het blonde siblings that will give you guys a really good grasp of what these genes do. So first off, this is what a classic looks like. So if you went out in the wild and saw these guys, this is the exact pattern you're going to see. This is what caused me to actually fall in love with this species, is I love how these normals look. One of the coolest just wild type patterns I think is out there in nature, and I think it looks better than almost any morph personally. Then you come to sunfire. Now sunfire is going to mess with the color a lot. As you can see, these orange flames on the side right here, absolutely gorgeous, and that's why they call it a floating tail. The other one I had that I sold at the show was a little bit better example of that, but you can see how gorgeous. There we go. You can see why they call it a floating tail, because it's not connecting to the bottom. And it does change the pattern a little bit too. So as you can see, it's a little more tight when you compare it with the actual normal, but mostly what it's going to do is mess with the color. And you throw that into albinos, like blonde, purple albino, white albino, email, you're going to be shocked at the outcome. It's going to really, really increase the contrast on that. Then we come to tiger. Now, I love tiger. My first ever retic I ever got from Bob Clark was a tiger, and they are gorgeous. Now, you can see it causes rosettes to go down the side here, changes the pattern up top, and changes the color slightly. Now, tiger, all these genes right here are what we in the reptile world call codominant. They're actually incomplete dominants. So if you breed a tiger to a normal, you're going to end up with half tigers, half normals. And if you breed a tiger to a sun, you'll get normals, tigers, suns, and sun tiger. And we're going to go put these guys back and show you guys a sun tiger real quick. So here is a sun tiger het blonde hatchling. She hatched out a little bit smaller, so we're still getting her up to the weight of her hatchling. But she's eating great now. And as you can see, this is a perfect combination of sunfire and tiger. You get the coloration of the sunfire, perfect combo of the sunfire and tiger patterns on there for a real beautiful, beautiful colored snake. And like I said, you throw these into albino and combination genes like anthrax, it's going to do some unbelievable combos that are going to leave you guys speechless. So I hope you guys learned something from that. As always, if you guys want any questions answered, comment below. Make sure you guys hit that subscribe button, hit that like button, and I hope to see you guys next time. Stay sophisticated.